the chairman of the board, Lucille.
Oh, he broke it.
He smashed that board across the chest of the grappler. Grappler is down.
Hello, everyone, and welcome to another exciting week of pro wrestling this week. I'm Joe Pedicino.
And I'm Gordon Soley. Highlighted this week on pro wrestling this week will be the second fall of our mat classic, that Shandor Sabu going up against Roger Mackie. The match took place in 1959. We'll see a light heavyweight title match in the World Class Championship Wrestling Organization. Plus, we'll have an update on the Survivor Series coming up in the WWF, wrestling from Memphis, Tennessee, and much, much more. But Joe, we start off in the Old West.
It's the Wild West, Gordon, as we're going to Dallas, Texas, and Bill Mercer in Wild West Wrestling. He was interviewing Rockin Robin this week when Debbie Combs came out, and she wasn't too happy. Take a look at what happened.
Exciting, Rockin Robin. Good to see you again. The last time we talked to you, you said you had a surprise for Susan Green, and you certainly did. You became her special referee. So that was an interesting situation, and then you took her on.
Yes, sir. The one thing that I've learned here is with every match, I learn something new. And that happened to be one of the things that I was just kind of holding back in my sleeve, and it worked out really well. And I think from here on out, things are going to go a little bit better for me,
well,
I hope.
The career, let's talk about the career. You're just new. You had that great star-fine bout and scored the highest mark of anybody. So things are coming along, aren't they?
Yes, sir, they really are.
What's going on here?
She's
nothing but a rookie. She's had two interviews already, and I've yet to see my first. Get out of here,
wait,
bag.
Wait a minute. Look.
Excuse me, Mr. Mercer. I'm sorry. I don't know what's going on.
I think I'll leave. Well, I don't know exactly what happened here, because we were going to do was talk to Rockin Robin, and along comes Debbie Combs here. Oh, my goodness. And Debbie, maybe she's upset because Rockin Robin has had so much fan support, and Debbie is a veteran of the wrestling wars. In fact, that her mother, Cora, has been wrestling for 35 years, so she is in the elite of the background of pro wrestling, but I don't know exactly why she has suddenly turned on Rockin Robin. They seem to be pretty good friends. Robin helped her. She helped Rockin Robin on the Susan Green problem. And now here it is, Debbie Combs. Look out, Robin, though, is back. Rockin Robin not going to take all that stuff. Now even the referee's coming in. This wasn't a sanctioned bout, but the referee's here. I don't know what they're doing. One, two, but Debbie Combs is tough. Rockin' Robin has turned this thing around a little bit. She and Debbie Combs get after it. Oh, good boot in the chest by Rockin' Robin. Another one, and Debbie now looks to be ready to escape. So Rockin' Robin pretty well set the pace here. She may be a rookie, as Debbie Combs said, but she certainly came out on top. She is considered an unofficial victory in a non-bout that emanated out of an interview situation. Now there she is.
Week continues now as we move on to the Alabama Heavyweight Championship, and that's still a hot item in the Continental area.
You know, Gordon, they've been having a real war over that title, as you, of course, are aware. We're going to see Tom Pritchard now in a rematch against the Dirty White Boy, and what starts out to be a match ends up a lot more.
You got to hand it to the Dirty White Boy. He's got a lot of fight back, too. Can't question that at all. That grueling match between these two. Remember, of course, the Alabama Heavyweight Championship is on the line.
If I was in there, I'd be the champion right now. I know how to beat Pritchard right now because I know Pritchard's every move from now. I taught him when he's hurt, how to come back from it and everything like this. I was like a religious leader to this man. I was like the man that stands up on top of the mountain looking down at the trees and each one of the monkeys in the trees, and I told him to go for the bananas, and that's what he's going for now. He's going for the bloody bananas. That's what he's doing.
Off the ropes. Uh-huh. Both men colliding. Both men colliding. Wait a minute. What's going on back there? What's going on now? Something happened. She definitely passed him something.
Wait, look at the bullet, man.
The bullet. Uh-huh, look at there.
Yeah, look at there. Look at him.
That flew off the hand.
Look at him. The ball's in the corner again. He's cut. Again, right for that title. One more time. Help Satan. I'm going to go down there and help Michael.
Well, I'll tell you what. He's off the hand of the dirty white boy, and now we've got the bullet in there. Mike Golden is charged into the ring, and now Lord Jonathan Boyd has just charged in. And we're going to have to get some kind of order restored. We've got to get some kind of order restored here. Well, we've got two on one. They've got Pritchard down. Jonathan Boyd and the dirty white boy. After the bullet was in there, Mike Golden. And a real problem here. Wait a minute. Wait a minute. The bullet just got that cat of nine tails. And he just gave it to the dirty white boy. He just missed as he went after Boyd. He catches Boyd. And the little lady disappeared in a hurry. So the bullet and Tom Pritchard have now cleared the ring. They have now cleared the ring. And all right. Tom Pritchard retains his Alabama heavyweight wrestling championship.
Dr. Tom Pritchard, badly lacerated, but he does hold on to the Alabama heavyweight championship. Sound Off is next, where you, the viewer, get a chance to ask your questions or voice your opinions. And for that, we go to the lovely Boni Blackstone. Boni?
Joe L. from Los Angeles, California, watching KCOP Channel 13, wants to know, when the announcer sees someone cheat, why doesn't he tell the officials? Joe, the rules of almost every wrestling association make it very plain that the announcers are not to be considered as officials themselves. It is the job of the announcer to point out not only to the officials, but to the fans, everything that goes on in the ring. The referee is not allowed to base any decision solely on what the announcer says. And listen to this from Jason R. of Lexington, Kentucky. Jason's watching WDKY, Channel 56. Ever since May of 1985, I have been watching wrestling, and my favorite person is Jim Cornette of the NWA. Once he asked everyone to send a letter to tell if they thought he should have to fight Ron Garvin in a cage match. I did not think that he should have. Could you tell Mr. Cornette I think he's number one? Oh, and another thing. Please tell him that his Midnight Express are the greatest tag team in the world. And many of you, like Shirley C. of Tucson, Arizona, watching KDTU Channel 18, want to know, how do you write the sexy and sadistic ladies of PAL? Shirley, I'm sure the ladies want to hear from you, so here's their address. Just write PAL, 12100 Northeast 16th Avenue, North Miami, Florida, 33161. I'm Boni Blackstone for Pro Wrestling This Week.
Well, that's how you can write the lovely ladies of PAL. And, of course, you saw our Sound Off address there with Boni on the screen during Sound Off, and we look forward to hearing from you. Right now, we're going to move to the AWA. More in that TV title tournament. This match between JT Southern and Soldat Ustinov. Let's see who is going to rack up the points in this one.
Soldat Ustinov with a body slam on JT Southern. He comes over for a leg drop, and JT gets out of the way.
JT, I think, is just going on instinct right now because he's been hammered pretty good.
Digs away to the body. He takes a clubbing forearm to the back of the head. Again, that forearm by Soldat Ustinov. JT has to buy some time here, or he may have bought the farm. Up and over he comes with a somersault. However, he gets only a two count here on Soldat Ustinov. That back of JT Southern seems to have been injured somewhere along the way in this match, as you see him reaching behind with that left hand and Ustinov taking advantage of it.
He's pounded on him.
Ustinov trying to get him up on a suplex. He does. Up and over he goes.
Well, his back is taking a beating tonight, Rod. He got out of there again.
His entire frame is taking a pounding from the 305-pounder out of the Soviet Union. Soldat Ustinov working over JT Southern in this television tournament match, with so many points going to the winner of the match and points being deducted for the loser of the match. And right now it looks all Soldat Ustinov. JT Southern takes a hard body slam.
He is taking a wrestling lesson tonight, or a pounding tonight, I should say.
Somehow or another, he beat the three count again. Here is a reversal, a small package, and a cover here. Oh. And JT Southern has quickly turned the tables on Soldat Ustinov. Talk about a turn of events, Vern Gagne. JT Southern.
So JT Southern takes the points in this TV tournament match from the AWA.
And I might just point out that the inside cradle is one of the most effective pinning combinations in professional wrestling. Well, the Danger Zone with Paulie Dangerously is next, right after we take this time out.
Well, all I'm going to say right here, oh, there's a vicious clothesline. I'll have to give him a little bit of credit.
Paul E. Dangerously has been taking it easy since his team, the Midnight Express, won the AWA World Heavyweight titles. Let's go now to the Danger Zone, and you'll see exactly what we mean.
Call you right back. You know, Kawasaki may make the good times roll, but Paul E. Dangerously makes the good times happen. And you know, this week I said on the Danger Zone, since Loverboy Dennis and Ravishing Randy are the new AWA world, you understand, world, all over the world, you know, America, Japan, England, I'm talking all over the world. Since they are the new world tag team champions, let's have a party. I mean, let's celebrate. Let's have a good time. And therefore, I'm going to once and for all show
the tape. That's right, the tape.
Right now, ladies and gentlemen, you people are going to realize that Loverboy Dennis and Ravishing Randy are the original Midnight Express.
Dennis Condrey and Randy Rose, indeed a team ahead of their time.
A tag team ahead of its time? That was 1979. It's 1987 now, almost 1988. The Midnight Express, their time has come. You understand? Because Paulie Dangerously led them to the AWA World Tag Team title. And I've now proven to everybody that we don't have to argue about the Midnight Express name anymore. We are the original Loverboy Dennis, Ravishing Randy, and now with them, their great manager, Paulie Dangerously, the AWA World Tag Team Champions. Now, wasn't that fun?
Well, I guess you could say that Paul E. deserves to lay back and take it easy after guiding the original Midnight Express to those titles. However, if I were Paul, I think I'd be a little bit careful of those challengers coming up fast from behind. Gordon, let's go now to our feature match of the week.
And our feature match this week does come from Portland, Oregon. It is the Northwest Heavyweight Championship match, Mike Miller defending against the Grappler. And you have to watch out for the Grappler.
Is on the line. The title is on the line in this particular match right here.
Yeah, this isn't just for the money, Don. This is for the title. This is for the King of the North, the champion of the Pacific Northwest. And that is recognized throughout the world. as a very, very prestigious title.
Absolutely. Absolutely. I mean, it's there's a lot of pride, there's a lot of soul to this, and there's a lot of exposure. I mean, you know, it's going to be in magazines, it's in newspapers. I see it in different magazines. And these guys know that. They want their name in there. They want their name under that belt.
Exactly.
Pacific Northwest Championship belt is held by, and they want their name there.
My goal's right up there. That Pacific Northwest is one of my
goals.
You
bet it is. You bet it is. Or you wouldn't be down at the gym working out. You wouldn't be getting into the ring risking your body.
That's, you're very true, Don. That is 100% correct. Something everybody shoots for.
Oh, a hard forearm from the grappler. And a reversal whip. Grappler into the rope.
Oh, man! Mike Miller, this is where the people give him. Look at the people.
He just about hung him out to dry, the grappler.
I never seen a clothesline like that.
Well, I haven't seen anybody come back so quickly either. Look at the grappler. He raked across Miller's face. The grappler coming off those top rope. And the grappler ran right into Mike Miller's fist. Miller comes back with the boot. Miller comes back with the fist.
Right after right and left. Shoots him in. Big elbow.
Oh.
Now he's on a roll. Now Mike Miller looks like he's ready.
He is. He is on a roll. Look at this. Boom. Right on the head. Boom. Another one. Miller with series of right hands. Yep. And now,
Hey, what's he doing?
He's loading that boot now. And Miller didn't see that. Now, see?
What's he doing?
Into the ropes goes. Look what I found. Let's play ring around the rose. And a little atomic drop. And, ran right into the referee. Sandy Barr is down. I think your dad may be hurt, right? Mike Miller's got the chairman of the board, Lucille.
Oh, he broke it. He smashed that board across the chest of the grappler. Grappler is down. And I think the grappler's going to be out. Wait a minute.
Here comes Chris Colt.
Come on. Get him out of there.
Miller sees him.
Wait a minute.
Now look out. Oh, come on.
He got that boot.
Yeah, he got right the. He loaded stomach. The boot again. And this time, grappler nailed Mike Miller with the boot. Come on. You can't. One, two. Oh,
you've got
to be kidding.
That boot is loaded, Don Koss. I've seen him loaded. You've seen him loaded.
And Sandy Barr had no way of seeing that. Sandy was on his face.
Chris Colt is gone out of the area now.
Chris Colt came in, did his dirty work. And the grappler wants the microphone. He wants the belt.
Wait a minute.
That belt has to be given him by the referee. He got the belt, and he's leaving with the belt.
He got the belt, and he's on his way out. I seen him load the boot. I seen Chris Colt.
Everybody saw that. You did that right in front of the camera. We've got it.
And so the grappler becomes the new Northwest Heavyweight Wrestling Champion. Mike Miller is far from satisfied and will want a rematch, that's for sure. Now we travel on to the WWA, formerly known as Central States in Kansas City. We're going to be hearing from Jay French. Now, he is the WWA Marketing Director, and he has some interesting information regarding a tournament upcoming.
Very long ago, that promoters from all over the world were expressing dissatisfaction with the wrestling scene today.
That's true. I've heard quite a bit about that.
And most of that stemmed from the inability to obtain a world champion for the different promotions. So what's happened now in a short time, and I'm proud to say that it is a reality, there is a World Wrestling Alliance. And it truly is a World Wrestling Alliance. And by that, what I mean is that there's promotions from all over the world that have joined together to form this alliance. And what the plans are at this point, and I want to emphasize that they're not complete, but we want to keep the fans up to date as to exactly what's happening. And at this point, plans are being formulated to hold regional tournaments all over the world.
Right.
Now, these tournaments will take place in Oregon, in the Pacific Northwest. They'll take place all over the United States, Mexico, and right here in the Central States also.
All right. All this leading, of course, towards a one-night centralized tournament to pick a new world's champion.
Exactly.
You know, Joe, that puts the grappler now, the new Northwest Heavyweight Champion, number one in line for that tournament that will be held in Portland.
That's true, and I think they're going to have top wrestlers from all around the world in the tournament for the WWA Championship. Some people we'll probably see in that tournament coming up now. New people in the WWA. They're called the Rock and Roll Rebels, an exciting team, and we're going to see them take on Russell Sapp and Prince Tapu.
Another thing, Grace. Oh, there was a little move right. Oh, there's a big tag there. Now we're going to see what Greg Gillis is made out of. Russell Sapp. Well, I'm going to say right here. Oh, there's a vicious clothesline. I'll have to give him a little bit of credit there. That's Prince Sapp making a save. Let me tell you something, Breeze. These guys have not drank from the silver chalice like the sensational bad. Oh, there's a big high backdrop. That wasn't bad. I have to give a little credit there. The Tapu comes in and makes the.
We've got all 4 men in the ring right now, Rick Stewart. Why doesn't the referee do something about it?
At the same time, the sensational back twist. I'm never in the ring at the same time. We never do anything illegal. We always tag. We always tag. We always tag.
Double drop kick for the Rock and Roll Rebels.
Drop kick for the sensational back twist. When are these guys going to realize they don't do the same thing that we do?
Look at this, up behind. Greg Gillis rolls up on Prince Tapu, having a little trouble getting those shoulders, but Gillis stayed right with us, come up with a small package.
Kick out!
1, 2, 3, I think we've got a winner for the Rock and Roll Rebels.
WTW continues now as we move on to the WWF. And Joe, two good friends of mine involved in this situation, superstar Billy Graham and Don Muraco.
That's right. You know, there has been a change in the Survivor Series lineup for Thanksgiving night. And we're going to show you why right now. It all started with a match between superstar Billy Graham and Butch Reed. And you'll see how Don Muraco got involved right now.
That's true.
Nine.
Oh, wait a minute.
Look at that! Right across the... Oh, wait a minute! Oh, yeah!
Hey! Now, he had no reason to bring Slick into the ring.
Well, was Slick good on the apron? He doesn't belong on the apron. Go ahead. Should pick him up and throw him over those top ropes. Teach him a lesson once and for all.
Get it!
Come on, Billy, hit him!
He's a manager. What do you mean, hit him?
Hit him! He deserves it. He's always interfering.
Superstar Bearhead!
Oh!
One man dead. The game coming in. Sending the Slickster.
This shows me right here, you want to mess with the manager, then you're going to pay for it. Because there's a lot of loyalty in wrestling between wrestlers and their managers.
What are they doing to him? Oh, no, got across the hip.
Right on that hip, too. Right on the bad hip. Look at that. Bar 400 and some odd pounds. Look at
that. Oh, my goodness. What are they trying to do to him?
I'll tell you what they're doing. They're going to end this career. That's what they're trying to do.
They're going to send him back to the doctor again. You mean to tell me we're going to have to watch one of those bloody operations?
Oh, coming in.
Look at Muraco go.
Jeez. And Muraco cleaning house. In there, we saw him earlier on. Muraco out there with Reed. And the wrong man gang.
Billy Graham's hurt.
Better believe he's hurt with what he took on that bad hip.
Well, he shouldn't be in there then. If he's
what
not
do you mean he should be in there?
They're
not attacked him with a chair or anything else.
Oh, come on. Come on now.
He dropped that superstar Billy Graham right out on the floor. And the problem for Muraco is there's just too many of them.
Certainly a tough situation for the superstar. There's no question about that after that miraculous comeback.
That's true. After the surgery on his hip, now to be put out of wrestling again by the forces of Bobby Heenan's team and Andre the Giant's team at the Survivor Series. Well, Don Muraco has not only volunteered, he's almost demanded to step in and to take the place of superstar Billy Graham, and I don't think that that hurts that team one bit. And I think the Survivor Series coming up Thanksgiving night on pay-per-view will be even more exciting. And you know, Gordon, they're having some real problems with the Survivor Series and the tag team tournament. That, of course, because on the side of what was the Hart Foundation's team, Demolition has started a revolt.
Yeah, revolution.
That's right. And they say that since the Hart Foundation are no longer the tag team champions, they, Demolition, should be the captains of that team. And I think I would watch for the Hart Foundation and Demolition to be at odds more that night than maybe with the other team. And I think that could lead to ruination for that team.
Yeah, a lot of things could be happening. There's certainly no question about that. Now, it's time to move on to our Matt Classic. As you remember, of course, last week, Roger Mackie was battling against Shandor Sabu. And, well, we're going to go to the second fall. This is a 2-out-of-3-fall event. Sabu taking the first one. Let's see what happens on this one.
Mackie still holding on to the head scissors, bridging on his head. Where's the count of one on Mackie, but he gets his shoulder rolled off the canvas before the count of two. First fall in this match went to Sanders Zabo. Young Mackie has to win this one to keep the match alive. Two falls for Zabo would win the match. Mackie comes up with an arm lock. Figure four position at the shoulder. Long arm bar by Roger Mackie. Roger over. They're on the canvas. Neither wrestler has any decided advantage in this position. Lozavo comes up with a headlock on young Mackie. They both have headlocks.
Here they are right out here in our laps. We're going to try to get the wrestlers out of the way. We don't want them right in our lap. Yeah. Well, I believe we can sit down comfortably again. They break and break cleanly, but I thought we were going to get a little wrestler right in our lap. And not a little wrestler. Roger weighs 210 pounds.
Well, the boys are in there in that arm and neck roll. The referee's old side headlock by young Mackie. He's got to win this fall to keep this match alive. Into the ropes goes Mackie. Right to the chin by Zabo. Kicks him away. Rolls him over. It's a rolling headlock. Side headlock and rolling hip lock. One, two, three. Series of side headlocks and rolling hip locks. Young Roger Mackie of Salt Lake City wins the second fall to make it.
Well, Mackie and his opponent each have one fall. I might point out that the match did continue. It went to a time limit draw, and so neither man was the victor. Next week, Moose Cholock and Frankie Adonis in our Matt Classic. And Joe, right now, a pair coming up.
That's right, 202 timeout for us, and we'll be back with more on Pro Wrestling This Week right after this.
We move now to the Cotton Bowl and the WCCW Light Heavyweight Championship match between Shaun Simpson and Eric Embry. Mark Lorenz brings us this special report.
Shaun Simpson behind on Eric Embry, picks him up, drops him down. Embry trying to squirm loose and reaches for the rope, and Shaun Simpson will break free. Embry a little reluctant to get back with him. Now, later in the match, Shaun Simpson has Eric Embry pinned in the corner. This match in total time lasts better than 15 minutes. As Shaun is so anxious to go after Eric, he actually is pushing the referee, John Keaton, down. Both men are weary now after this long, hard fight, and John Keaton is signaling for the bell to be sounded. Shaun is still all over flamboyant Eric Embry. You see Sean's brother Steve there at ringside watching with an eye injury. The dazed Embry falls out of the ring before he can even rebound into the oncoming Shaun, and Shaun leaps from the ring with a big foot to the back. Many of the fans standing now as Shaun and Eric have gotten into a brutal battle. This is the kind of excitement that you will see at the Hollywood, Florida Sportatorium in the greater Miami area, Saturday night, November the 21st. The Iron Sheik, Kevin and Kerry Von Erich, Al Perez, Bruiser Brody, Mills Mascaris, and much, much more. As Embry is thrown into the steel post, they ring the bell all they want to, but they can't get them stopped.
The referee John Keaton disqualifies Shaun Simpson for abusive contact with the referee. Still light heavyweight champion of the world, Flamboyant Eric Embry.
When a champion gets disqualified, he loses the belt. But when the challenger gets disqualified, as Simpson did, the champion keeps the belt.
A very uncharacteristic move by Shaun Simpson. Roughing up the referee gets him disqualified. And, of course, he cannot win the title by getting disqualified. Right now, it's time for our Pro Wrestling Illustrated report with Bill Apter. Now, we've had several requests wanting to know where are the ratings. They'll be back next week in a new version. The Pro Wrestling This Week TV Wrestling Ratings. And we want you to be here for the premiere of what we call the Nielsens of the Wrestling World, coming up next week on Pro Wrestling This Week. But right now, it's time for our commentary of the week. It's about Kerry Von Erich's return to the ring. So let's go to New York and Bill Apter.
In June 1986, Kerry Von Erich was in a terrible motorcycle accident. He sustained an injury to his right ankle, he dislocated his hip, and he lacerated his right knee. Well, it took several months for Kerry to say, "I'm feeling better," and make a comeback. The comeback was last February against Brian Adias. Well, during that match, he broke a bone in his heel and he was sidelined all over again. Now, Kerry admitted it was a mistake. He said it was too much too soon. He had several more medical procedures done, and then on October 17th, Kerry decided once again to make a comeback. He sparred with three opponents, Frankie the Thumper Lancaster, Killer Brooks, and Matt Bourne. And he said he felt pretty good, but he did admit, after several people told us that he limped back to the dressing room, he did admit that he wasn't feeling 100%. Editor Dave Rosenbaum spoke to Kerry Von Erich shortly after that match, and Kerry said he didn't deny limping after the Cotton Bowl workout, but he did claim that the ankle was not the cause. Kerry said, "It was my knee that bothered me. A long time ago, I messed up my knee real bad. That combined with all the years I played football and when I threw the discus really banged up that knee. What happened now is the muscles are still weak around that knee from taking a year and a half off. Once I start getting more active, it shouldn't be any problem. As for my right ankle, it feels no different than the other one." So, Kerry Von Erich, the comeback, miracle or mistake, we'll all know the day after Thanksgiving. For Pro Wrestling Illustrated, this is Senior Editor Bill Apter. See you at the matches.
Well, let's move on now to Memphis, Tennessee. And I'll tell you what, Joe, whenever you're looking for wild, unexpected action, you'll find it in Memphis.
No different this week. We've got Memphis Vice going up against Hector Guerrero and Dr. Diablo. Hector's got that hair cream out again, and he's going to blind somebody, but not who he thinks.
Hang on, Hector.
Come on, Lewis!
Guerrero.
Stands him up and then goes down to complete the suplex.
Well, he rattled that entire ring when he hit, too. Lou Winston coming back. Notice on the back of his tights, all Lou has is just the initials LW.
Yeah.
Everybody in there. Guerrero going against Bryant. Lou Winston, Dr. Diablo, having him tied up over in the ring. That's Guerrero slamming Jerry Bryant's head into the turnbuckle. There you see all the action. There are two separate corners. Guerrero really pounded Jerry Bryant. And he helps tie Lou Winston up in the ropes across the way. Dr. Diablo grabs Bryant.
Down on the mat over the rope. Hey, Hector!
Come on, Hector.
Guerrero over here and grab that hair remover
bottle.
Here comes Bill Dundee.
Going to end up probably being a disqualification against the Memphis Vice. But Bill comes in there and nails Hector and Dr. Diablo. Dundee putting the midsection from behind. Guerrero going after him, telling Dr. Diablo to grab him. Big Lou tied up in the rope. The top coming off that hair. Oh! He threw it. Dundee ducked. He caught Dr. Diablo right in the face with it. And we saw what that did to Jim Jameson's hair. Diablo got caught right in the face with that Hector's hair remover. Randy Hale's coming out. Dr. Diablo and Eddie Marlin is Dr. Diablo kicking around. Oh, man, that stuff has got to burn. Woo! Caught him right in the face, Dave. Bill ducked. And as Hector was throwing it at Bill, it hit Dr. Diablo right in the face.
Well, sometimes it just doesn't pay to get up in the morning, and if you're Dr. Diablo, that was the day. It looked like Hector was going to be throwing the cream into the face of Bill Dundee, but the quick thinking and action of Dundee, he ducked, and it ends up in the face of Dr. Diablo, and next week we'll find out about the condition of the good doctor. You know, Gordon, it's time to talk about one of my favorite topics, 56 meals.
56 meals on the big Great Escapes Travel Dream Cruise. It's coming up February 7th through the 14th. I might point out that it's 2 more weeks, that's right?
That's right. There's only 2 more weeks for you to register to go on the cruise. Now, they still have the 3-month payment plan, so with a small down payment and 2 more payments, you can qualify to go on the Dream Cruise. There are still some terrific prices left on those cabins. There will be the Wrestling Trivia Tournament with the Gordon Soley Wrestling Trivia Game there on board, and we will be crowning a world champion at Wrestling Trivia. We will also, of course, have great wrestlers like Bruiser Brody, Jerry Lawler. We are going to have Red Bastine, Wendy Richter will be there, that and a lot more. And unfortunately, Paul E. Dangerously will be there, and I have heard this week he has threatened to bring the Midnight Express and their, quote, entourage along.
Well, that should be interesting indeed. And if you're interested in going on this cruise, may I suggest you call this number right now and find out further information. Please call area code 818-963-9684. That's area code 818-963-9684.
And Gordon, it should be a terrific cruise of the Caribbean, including those big wrestling matches down in San Juan, Puerto Rico, from the World Wrestling Council. We look forward to seeing you there. We're going to take a break. We've got commercials coming up, and we'll be right back with more on Pro Wrestling This Week. More action coming up on Pro Wrestling This Week, but right now it's time to take a look at the NWA and the UWF and Starrcade. Gordon, it's the last show before Starrcade, and we said we would make some predictions.
We did indeed, and, well, we might as well start at the very, very top. Let's start with the rematch between the man with the hands of stone, Ronnie Garvin, and the former NWA World Heavyweight Champion, Ric Flair.
Well, it'll be in a cage. It is a rematch, and who are you picking? I'll let you go first.
Well, I'll tell you what. I really have to feel that Flair is going to regain the title.
Well, you know, Starrcade has been a lucky omen, you might say, for Flair. It has always done well for him, and I have to agree with you. I expect Ric Flair to win the title back at Starrcade this year.
All right, now, let's take a look at a very, very critical match, that one between Dusty Rhodes, the American Dream, and Lex Luger. And I'll tell you right up front, I think conditioning is going to be a critical factor in this match, and I have to go with Lex Luger.
Can't agree with you on this one, Gordon. I believe there's too much at stake for Dusty Rhodes. You know, he's got his career on the line. He's going to have to be literally out of the business for 90 days anywhere in the world if he loses. And I will agree with you that conditioning will be important, but I think in the heart, Dusty Rhodes will win this match.
Interesting observation. All right, let's move on to Terry Taylor and Nikita Koloff. Great unification match, and I'll tell you what, I think the youngster originally from Lakeland, Florida, is going to get the nod.
No, this one has to go to Nikita Koloff. This one goes to Nikita because of conditioning. The same reason you gave earlier. I just think Nikita will be too strong for Terry Taylor, who is a fine competitor. Don't agree a lot with his attitude lately, but I think Nikita's conditioning will pay off.
All right. Tag team action next. The Rock and Roll Express going up against the Midnight Express. The Rock and Rollers have my vote.
Well, Gordon, we seem to be disagreeing a lot today. I think that you factor in Jim Cornette and you factor in Big Bubba, and even on that scaffold, I'm afraid I've got to go with the Midnight Express.
Well, finally, let's talk about Barry Windham and, of course, Steve Williams. I've known Barry for a long time, and he is one of the greatest athletes I've known in the sport in a long time. I have to go with Barry.
This is probably the toughest match in Starcade for me to predict because both of these people are such tremendous athletes, and they both are at the top of their profession in their own way. But I am going to go with Steve Williams. I'm going to go with Dr. Death only just on a hunch. I really just don't have a reason. I think it's such a close match, but I'm going to go with Steve Williams.
Fair enough. Well, at least we've given you our predictions. We'll find out what happens next week, that's for sure.
Right.
Our international match this week takes place in San Juan, Puerto Rico, as Carlos Colon goes up against Kareem Muhammad.
Referee counting. Here comes Kareem. He misses as he lunges forward to get Carlos. Get up, champion is angry. He has exploded with all his strength. He's going for some blood on Kareem. Punching him right on top of the head. And Kareem. Being rocked here by Universal Champion Carlos Colon. That knows that he is against a top contender. Headbutts him. African is rocked. It's almost lights out for him as the stadium lights are getting harder for his eyes to see as he is being rocked and stunned by the punching and now the kicking of Carlos, the champion, aggressive. Now he's biting the challenger. The title is on the line. Carlos Colon has opened up a cut on the head of Kareem. A lot of blood gushing out from Kareem Muhammad. And look out, manager Tiki Star attacks Carlos, disqualification.
Well, Tiki Star stuck his nose where it didn't belong and caused the massive Kareem Muhammad to be disqualified. Joe Powell.
That's right. Time for the Women's Wrestling Association, and we're going to go see one of my new sweethearts now. Her name is Tiffany Crystal, and boy, does she have a job in front of her. She's taking on Luna.
Oh, right into the turnbuckle. Tiffany Crystal doing the job on Luna. Jamming her head right into the bottom of the mat. Pushing her back in so they don't have the 20 count. Jim Burke, the referee, counting.
I tell you, that Tiffany's one tough customer too, David. She's a nice-looking girl, but she's tough. It's too bad she's been such a roughneck.
You know, you saw a few weeks ago, or last week, I forget, I've seen so many matches. Oh, my! What a maneuver, taking that neck of Tiffany Crystal. Coming in a few weeks, a tag team elimination for the belts.
I have to admit that Luna is one of the roughest lady wrestlers I've seen, and that's it.
Yes! Luna!
I've never seen anything like that.
Nail. On today's Pro Wrestling This Week, but Gordon, you know, a lot of people wait for this point right here where we tell them who the Wrestler of the Week is.
Well, there was certainly no question about our Wrestler of the Week this week. The board unanimously chose The Rock himself, Don Muraco. First of all, for his selfless act in trying to help out superstar Billy Graham, and then for his offering to take his place. Let's take a look at that incident as it occurred.
Hurt. Better believe he's hurt with what he took on that bad hip.